Welcome to the Center of Light Radio with spiritual teacher, intuitive, musician, composer, and best-selling author of The Divine Principle, Anchoring Heaven on Earth, your host, Keith Anthony Blanchard.
Coast to coast, pole to pole, all around the world on the internet, thanks to the marvel of technology. I'm coming at you live from my guest house in Memphis, Tennessee. This is Keith Anthony Blanchard, and you are listening to Center of Light Radio, Center of Divine Unfoldment and Reinforcement. Said another way, radio for the soul, y'all. I want to say thanks to Bernard Dissect and the rest of my spiritual band members from my group Lavender Soul. That's the intro music you heard, the one that's about a minute long as the intro to the show, as well as the song previous to that by the name of Choice. We all have choices. We can choose this or that. We can go mountain climbing. We can go skydiving, or we can choose thoughts that put us in a situation that we never thought we would want to manifest in our lives. So it's important that if we're going to create by default, if we create by default, we might as well get with the conscious, deliberate program of manifesting our lives, don't you think? I have a fantastic show for you today. My guest is going to be Mr. Brian Hardin. If I'm not mistaken, Brian has, like, when he lived in Nashville, 183 or plus gold albums to his credit. He's made a lot of movies. I think he did a documentary movie with the Dalai Lama. We'll get to some more about Mr. Brian Hardin here shortly. Also, if you have not been to the brand new website, Center of Light Radio's website, go there. You can go there at centeroflightradio.com. I just updated it for the new year. It looks really, really cool. When you get there, you'll see my mugshot, as well as the layout of the background and the font. This came to me in a very, very powerful dream about the future of Center of Light Radio. Hence, the opening page looks like marble with gold lettering. Maybe one night I will share that profound mystical experience of why I use that as my welcome page screen and shot. While you're at Center of Light Radio, opening page next to my picture, you will see a subscription form. Fill that thing out. People have been doing a lot lately, and I'm grateful for that. If you do, you have not only will you have access to my monthly newsletter, and I put a lot of time and work into it. I really go into the rabbit hole to find the purest sources of information I could find, because it's empowering to me. And in turn, I want to hand that to you. But also, you have access to my RPM recognized plugin and Manifest Your Life program, which is a once a month kind of thing for a year. And it's not to fix you because you're broken. It's about finding ways to help you expand into your greatest possible life so you can put your feet on the path to your bliss. Are you living your bliss? That's a very, very simple and powerful question. So welcome to 2017, y'all. It's a good year. It is a good year. There's going to be lots of changes. Are you on your game? Again, like I said at the intro of this program, you might as well be, and I support you in doing that. There's going to be lots of things happening. Your life can be exponentially blissful, or it can become topsy-turvy, and that's really, really all up to you about looking inward. But my greatest suggestion to you about how to make sense of what's going on with your life is to stay out of the outside world, stay completely out of it, you know, interact with it. Always use the idea that you can imagine that you're living on this earth plane, but you're a ghost. You can experience it, you can witness it, but you can't interact. What a great disposition to be in as we move further into this window of 2017. But also, my strong words for you of support is get out of the fight. Get out of the fight. What do I mean by get out of the fight? I mean, stop fighting. Stop fighting the world. Stop fighting the people in your life, be it relatives or even strangers. Stop fighting yourself with whatever internal dialogue you may be having with yourself. It's very, very important that you get out of fight and struggle energy and begin to move with the flow of the cosmic stream. If you look in your life and there's difficulty or there's an event that's happening, move into that situation. Breathe your way through it. Breathe your way through it. Make yourself okay by your breath. Because if you don't dissipate these issues in your life, trust me, if you do not resolve these issues in your life, God forbid there come a day where things blow up to a level that this earth school becomes too intense. And on some level, you may not even be aware of. You check yourself out, be it through an illness, car accident, or however about that your soul may find it most purposeful for you to exit. But remember, if you want to stay in this earth plane and hang out with me, which I would like you to do, make sure that, you know, you do the prerequisite work, that which is needed. Life-changing presentations I've been doing for many, many years. I provide many, many services. I can come to you and cater to your theme, be it about spirituality, the different degrees of it, divine incarnations. I consider myself to be an extraterrestrial target. I don't remember making this contract, but I can cater to your theme, or whatever the theme may be, about coming to you and giving a live presentation. Spiritual readings, I do spiritual readings. I stay away from the psychic word. That's a very, very dangerous word for me. But I'd be glad to help you by being a second pair of eyes, a second pair of ears, to help you get clear on something you may not see, because sometimes we are very, very too close, in fact, to our own lives. I'm here for you. I'm here as a support system for you. But also, throughout my life, my quote career, my spiritual walk, I've come across many people who are asking for some help by the removal of dark energies, bad people, ghosts, and all that stuff that doesn't make life fun being in your house. You got shadow people, and you have just others who are hanging around. You know, we need to get down to the bottom of it so you can have some peace in your house, peace in your mind, peace in your heart. I come with an arsenal. A serious arsenal of powerful information, powerful pictures, powerful mantras that will lift the vibration of you and your house, and they will be gone as quick as they came. And I will be in it with you all the way to the end. Tonight, my guest is Brian D. Hardin, and we will be speaking about the evolution of consciousness. Brian says, I'm addicted to thought and addicted to creativity. I am always making something, studying something, or playing with something. I believe that imagination is more important than knowledge. I try to play more than I think. I follow my intuition, my heart, turn off the judgment, basically get out of the fight. Good one, Brian. Including judging myself, I have been blessed to be able to meditate and be in ceremony with great elder leaders, Lakota, Hopi, Mayan, Tibetan, Incan, Mexican, a few other different tribes I won't begin to try to pronounce, Navajo, Cherokee. And he also says, I am focused on sharing messages of hope and understanding to the world. Kind of sounds like he and I are in parallel paths. I am obsessed with creating great projects and sharing a clear explanation of what changes are happening to humanity and how we are all unifying and collectively raising and shifting our consciousness. Brings me back to the point of how we need to get out of that fight energy that I spoke about. And, you know, as we all do, meditation is a wonderful catalyst. But my question to you is, are you meditating even with your eyes open? When you go throughout your daily life, driving your car, speaking with people, as you interact with the world, are you in a state of meditation? If you are, I am so happy about that for you. If not, meditation is not necessarily that which is in the formal way of the lotus position and doing a certain amount of breaths in this nostril, out this nostril, and back and forth, and in all these different ways. And these are all, mind you, phenomenal ways of bringing yourself to a state of absolute center and clarity and peace. But when we begin to bring this from said meditation into our waking-eyed life, can make your whole life a beautiful song, beautiful meditation. And that way, nothing can come into your experience without your permission that will shift you from that sacredness of your own centered self, your own centered space. Passion, sincerity, humility, and vulnerability. These four attributes, or attributes of Creator, attributes of God, because, you know, as we look on about, it's pretty doggone obvious to me that Creator is passionate, or none of this can have come about. But all, you know, and also passion happens to be the active. But sincerity would be the feminine aspect, which be the softer, the counterpoint to the passion. And mind you, even though it's subtler in energy, it is equally, if not more so, powerful, holding all of it together. But something about humility. Humility is that place where we realize it's not about us. And people might say, well, Keith, isn't spirituality really all about you, all about us, myself, actually? Well, it is, but it really doesn't come in that form, because there's a greater reward that happens when you make it about other people. Then it becomes about you. And finally, the word vulnerability. Let's interchange that word vulnerability with naked or expose. Because when you expose your core to everyone, that which you want to manifest in your life begins to happen because you are peeling yourself open and allowing that light to shine. And I understand it can be very, very intimidating to be, quote, naked in front of people, just like it is in the physical way, because, you know, it takes some time in doing to peel off your clothes, to peel off your skin, to peel yourself open, to allow that which has been hidden to be seen, because there's an amazing amount of trust that has to happen. So that trust factor begins with you to know that when you expose yourself, everything's going to be as it should be. But it's very, very tough for people to allow themselves to be seen fully. And we all have our secrets. That's our sacredness, right? I get it. I definitely get it. Brian, welcome to Center of Light Radio, my brother.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm excited to talk about some of the things that are in your book and some of the things your viewers all love. So please guide me. Would you lead us into something that's exciting for these times that people need to hear?
Good question. How do we support ourselves, each other, and the rest of the world, people who are unconscious, and to exponentiating the energy so we have not only a smoother transition into our best collective lives, but to speed that up?
Well, isn't the truth that the answer to every question is love? And obviously what we're being fed is a lot of fear, and our habits are out of fear. You know, we're actually programmed by the TV to be in fear, and all this, you know, talk of the elections and the end of the world and all the other things just keep us in fear. And really, when we're in the moment and we're in love and we love one another like Jesus would say, you know, then and we see each other in the eye, see ourselves in the eyes of others, and we don't judge like Jesus said, and so on. When all of a sudden we start acting right and being in the moment and loving one another, well, then we are in love. You have two choices in life. Yum or yuck, love or fear, create or decay. And if you're not creating something or in love with something or yum, feeling good, then it's the opposite. And so whenever we do a prayer, when we pray, we give gratitude, we give thanks, and we focus on what we, and so we're in that yum mode, we're in that happy, loving, positive mode, and there's no room for anything else. With the Native Americans recently, they have been fighting to keep their water, because water is life, and they did these ceremonies of prayer where they call it Wopida. Wopida, and the Wopi La would be the Lakota name. This is the Dakota name, and it's just giving thanks, and it's universal in all religions and all spiritual practices, that when we give thanks, when we're in that yum and the positive and we're in love, we're not in fear, and so we can act right. Pretty simple.
Totally agreed. Brian, you know, now I know why they call young Indians braves, because what they're doing at the North Dakota pipeline requires such, because what they are standing up for, they is way beyond the pipeline. What they're standing up for is so far beyond what we think is happening on this plot of land. My question to you is, a minute ago you had mentioned, you know, what is the answer for everything, and that's love. Many people, Brian, I think you would agree with me, don't have a clue what love is. They think it's a sentiment. You met someone, and it's this ping pong of emotions back and forth that you have with a partner. So, but let's get out of the gray area and all the crossfading that can happen through these different types of love. In your thoughts, sir, in your conviction, what you've learned, what you have experienced in your life, bones to bones, what is love, so everybody can understand and we all get on that same page of how to make changes through said love?
have you ever studied any Greek? They have multiple different forms of love.
No, and, I have not.
They have a word agape. That is part of that. But with those multiple forms of love, one is obviously self-love. And if I don't love myself, I can't love anyone else as an equal. So here's multiple levels. One is love yourself, and then love each other as equals. If I hate myself, I'm going to hate everything around me and everybody. I'm going to start taking instead of giving. So one is obviously that the love of a self, and then love of family or those close around you. And then as we keep going out, we start to see ourselves in everything and God within everything. Love to me isn't necessarily a thing we're trying to achieve or receive only. It's a thing you give, and it's also action. It's almost like if you want love, you have to give love. If you want chaos, you give chaos. If you want anger, you give anger. And so every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. That's a law of physics. But do unto others in the golden rule is a law of all world religions, not only Christianity, but every world religion has that in. So when we give something, we get it back. We're a reflection. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. So, Brian, as we look out in the world, it can be quite convincing. We see terrorism and ISIS and all these events, and we're being manipulated. And we get all that. We understand these are words we use to describe such events. What is really happening through these events that we label as bad in the world?
Oh, that we're in fear. Obviously. Yum or yuck, we have two choices. So if we're sitting there in fear and all worried and stressed about all the problems of the world and don't focus on those close around us and so on, then our emotions are uneasy. We're uneasy. And that leads to dis-easy or disease.
Yes, yes.
And so within that, we actually have a society that has been programmed by our news, if you call it that, organizations that feed sensationalism and fear and so on. And they don't feed the love. Our TV stations promote TV shows that show murder and death and rape, but you can't have any lovemaking, any real true connection, any growth. And so within our news, our TV, our films, the whole thing, we're being programmed. So I've been happiest when I turn off the TV, I don't go to see films, and I instead create music, create art, create with my friends, create laughter, watch comedy, and so on. And it's like yum or yuck. My choice is to focus on those things that bring me the good energy. So within all that programming, the news and so on, if we turn it all off and ignore it for a little while, we change our frequency. And then when we go back to it, we can see with new eyes what really might be going on. Like, I actually personally believe that there's a lot more layers than the obvious that are being fed to us on the corporate-owned news channels. We went from 50 news channels down to 6 over the course of the last 10 or 15 years. And it's very easy to control 6 news channels and what is being programmed, the messages and the stories. And to me, the diversity of the world and the diversity of opinions is what makes us all collectively great. Not having one opinion, but having millions or billions, you know?
That's really where I was going with the question, and my apologies, I wasn't clear. You said looking at the world or things with new eyes, and my goal was to ask you the question about perception, about what is really going on, that this is an extension of the collective mind. So how do we go about changing our perceptions of what's happening, because obviously what's happening is for our growth. It's the excuse, or is it the excuse that we collectively are using to help us expand through collective trouble?
So is it the excuse? Could you explain that?
In other words, we are manifesting these events to unfold the way they are. Hopefully that is going to get us out of the human quagmire.
Oh, well,
How do we change our perceptions about all the what we would call bad in the world? Because, you know, everyone will tell you my news source is better than yours. Mine is accurate and the rest are bunk.
And my God is better than yours.
Right.
I mean, it is actually kind of funny how we all do that. You know, what we call water has many names and it's still wet. Same thing with God, and same thing with love, same thing with fear. And really, actually, here's probably something that might lead us in the right direction. We have been trained and programmed to going to school 12 years, 40 hours a week, and so on.
Unless you quit.
Yeah, exactly, unless you quit. But we've been programmed to, we are what we think. You're your mind. You're what you think. And, you know, there's three pieces to us. There's the body and the mind, the spirit. In Christianity, they talk about the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. The Father would be like the mind. The Jesus would be the body. That's so the mind and the body. But then there's this whole other thing we rarely ever talk about, which is the Holy Spirit. What is the Holy Spirit? To a lot of people, they don't understand it, and so they don't even approach it. And it's really, if you look into it, it's the feeling. So instead of our mind taking lead, it's really letting the heart take lead, letting the feeling take lead. Part of this evolution in consciousness is that shift from head to heart, from me and my ego and my mind and my control mechanism to my heart and my allowance and my intuition and my collective, where I think of we and how I connect with nature and each other and what's good for all people. And does that make sense?
Absolutely. Any suggestions how someone who may be, quote, new to the conscious spiritual path can begin that process of shifting from the mind into living in the heart space?
Oh, yeah. There's a million great ones. Now, you know, what we call meditation is similar to prayer. And most people do both of them in weird ways. But I kind of feel like both are kind of like juggling. You can always add another ball. There's always more complex ways of doing it and so on. But when I simplify it back down to going to the feeling, not the mind, and see, my mind and my ego, saying a prayer or meditating from my mind would be really funny. A prayer from my mind would be, give me a new Ferrari, God, I need one, you know, and meditation from the mind would be, I have to go on this little path and through this little door. But meditating from the heart or praying from the heart is a different thing. It's really like that gratitude that we were just talking about. When we're in the heart, the gratitude is the, and the thanks and the feeling of love. So first thing I do when I do either pray or I meditate is I smile and I breathe.
Yeah, you're already setting a tone. Love it.
Yeah. And so I start feeling the feeling of what I desire. So, you know, if I want the Ferrari, if I want love in my life or whatever, I have to feel love in my life. I have to feel successful. I have to feel clearer. And when we turn off the mind and the need and the lack and that fear, and we go to the heart and we put the heart back into that love space, all right, so do it with me right now. Just smile and breathe and start feeling the feeling of that, what you're feeling.
It happens immediately. Yeah, it happens immediately.
And you start letting go of the grasping and the clutching and, you know, those tight tension that your clenched fist and your clenched shoulders and your clenched neck and your clenched forehead and the mind and all that things start letting go and your heart opens up. And so when you do that and you start telling yourself simple little things like everything's perfect, like, whatever your version of God is, wouldn't create this life for you and these crises or problems unless you are strong enough to overcome them and grow. And so know that every problem is a crisis or whatever, that is an opportunity to
opportunity.
Learn.
Opportunity, yeah.
Yeah, and so when we can learn and grow and look at everything as an opportunity to learn and grow, it's exciting. Yay!
And see, that's full circle the question I asked you about what's happening in the world, perception. When we see these events versus them being horrible in these really, really bad things. And in the world arena, yes, they are. But if we're serious about making change, those events that are happening are truly opportunities that are manifesting as excuses that we, in a way that we might understand so we can manipulate it and bring about the heaven on earth existence that we all want as a collective.
Mm-hmm. So the feeling that you want or desire is in that heart space. And so when we say imagination, look at the word I, magi, as in magic or creation, and nation.
Wow.
I imagination. So when nation or creation you desire, you are in control of, so with your imagination. So when we go to the feeling of the feeling we want to have when there's peace on earth, when there's abundance for all, when there's no such thing as a hunger or a war or even literally money, because money is a man-made creation. But instead, abundance for everybody, where we love and share and care and take care of each other. Wouldn't that be a brilliant world to imagine? And my imagination is going to that more often, which gets me into a feeling of not only my own calm, peace, freedom, clear-mindedness, not muddle-mindedness of the fear, but clear-mindedness of the feeling of love, then all of a sudden I can, from that place, I can give, I can care and share and help. And if you're depressed in life or you're not going anywhere, start helping someone that's less than you, that needs help.
Dig it.
And as soon as you do that, you feel better. And then you have a community. And then you have more and more people. And then once you have the community, there's your love. And then, and what, honestly, you can't, when you die, you don't take any of this stuff with you. And so making money and fighting for land or property or whatever, you know, or ego is also silly, because, I mean, Jesus himself was homeless. Buddha was homeless, you know, and Jesus, Buddha, and Muhammad all Jesus wasn't a Christian. Buddha wasn't a Buddhist. Muhammad wasn't a Muslim. And they all weren't saying, follow my church. They were saying, love one another is the golden rule. And they all had it in all of their things, including any other world religion that's a major one, has that same little principle. So, I mean, I go back to the golden rule.
But sure, Keith Anthony Blanchard here, your host of Center of Light Radio, 6 p.m. Eastern Time, Monday nights. You can find me sitting in this chair conducting all the affairs of the heart. Keith Anthony Blanchard here with Center of Light Radio to remind you about my lifelong work, RPM, Recognize, Plug In, and Manifest Your Life. Let me ask you a few questions. What is it you want out of your life? You want more financial stability? You want relationship? You want greater degrees of bliss, conscious expansion, and spiritual evolvement? These are magnificent, wonderful things, and I have achieved all of these by implementing what I am offering to you so you can apply this to your life so you can have all those things that you truly desire and truly deserve. I absolutely guarantee my work 100%. Go to Center of Light Radio. Look at the opening page, the bottom right-hand corner of your screen. You will see a subscription form. Fill it out. Not only will you receive my awesome Power Pack newsletter monthly, but you will have access to my RPM program. Stay in touch with me, and I will send you everything I'm about, all my successful works. You can bet. All you have to do is contact me, KeithAnthonyBlanchard@gmail.com. Peace, love, and light to you always. Brian, speaking of the heart, we have been talking about feeling. I recently did it. It's like you and I are really connected because everything you're talking about, I just did with an interview. I said at the beginning of the show before we got you on the air, an interview by Dr. Rita. She interviewed me sometime last week, and we were talking about, okay, we all have feelings. Now, when you begin to feel your feelings versus just having them, you will discover there are so many different tones, so many different shades of feeling, and there's so much information encrypted in feeling far beyond any words can possibly describe that we've ever invented yet. And when you become proficient at realizing, for example, if you have joy or whatever the feeling is, there are so many different layers to that feeling, and each part of that feeling is a vibration. And when you are proficient and you've done your work, you're able to go directly to the feeling that you know will call forth that Ferrari in your life, because we have to make an available space within us. Yes?
Oh, yeah. But you might actually find that putting yourself in the feeling of having the Ferrari not only tunes yes. you to attracting the Ferrari, but it also tunes you to another level where you don't even need the Ferrari anymore. And that the Ferrari was the ego thing. That yes. was the mind and the ego. And that instead you take the same amount of money that just got attracted to your positive energy and you give it away for free to charity or taking care of homeless or needy or hungry or building a school or doing some new creative invention that the world needs. And so the ego little Ferrari thing turns into magic of helping millions, you know?
You know, and you were talking about make the feeling very tangible that you have the Ferrari. And I'm going to send you a video later. I made with these videos are called Burst of Light. You're going to kill yourself laughing because of the content of what we're talking about. But when we make the feeling real, go to a dealership where they have such vehicles, sit in it, start it up, ask if you can test drive it, feel the engine purr beneath you. All that being said, these are ways that you can bring such a car into your life or whatever it is you're asking for. But what you really want, like Brian just said, is not the car. What you really want is the feeling that the car will bring you, right?
Yes.
Right. And yeah. Right. And then when you realize that you now have the resources to purchase such a vehicle or whatever it is you're asking for, it may just not be that important anymore. And so now you have this reservoir, these resources of endless abundance to do whatever you want with, which you could have dropped $100,000 on such a vehicle. Now you have these resources to do whatever it is you want, because the car really was an excuse to find that buzz that you think the car would give you.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, it's funny. We say everything matters. Everything matters. And matter, right. Matter is energy, and we are energy. And when whatever our thought energies, whatever our feeling energy goes to, we attract. They say that your brain actually doesn't have that big of a electrical or magnetic resonance as opposed to your heart, which has this huge resonance. So when you get the feeling of your heart right, because you've let go of the fears and doubts in your mind, but go to love, your heart takes lead. Your heart creates this resonance, and it's like a magnet. It attracts love. You give love, you get love. And all of a sudden, instead of being impossible, you say, I am possible. I am my own creation. So God becomes within you. God is within the love that is within you. So to me, it's real simple. I think Einstein said something like this. Whatever energy you want, that's what you attract. But it's like tune yourself to that frequency. It's actually science. It's not just spirituality. It is science that we do that. You know, the physical and the mental and the spiritual all go together. That's with Christianity. It was Father, Son, Holy Spirit, body, mind, spirit. And you know, we're leading ourselves into a really cool place. Like every part of this evolution of consciousness, we had a physical revolution of the Industrial Revolution, and that happened, you know, 150 years ago. And before 150 years ago, if I would have told you that you were going to be able to walk into a room and flip a little switch and the light of the sun is going to come on in the middle of the night, or if I told you you turn a little knob and the heat from a fireplace energy is going to just come out of the walls without any fire, and you would have thought I was absolutely crazy. So we had the physical revolution. Then we've had the mental revolution of the information age. And when I was growing up in high school, I remember dreaming of this little black box that one day we could ask it a question and it would just give us the answer, and that we wouldn't need to have any libraries anymore because it would all be in my pocket in a little black box. And now everybody's got one. And so we've had a physical revolution. We have had an information age of a mental revolution, body, mind. And our next revolution that we're on now is our spiritual revolution. So just like the energy of flipping a light switch. And if I would have told you about electricity, 150 years ago, you would have thought I was crazy. Within that same idea with spirituality, if I were to tell you some of the things that my intuition is telling me about the future, like we will not any longer need language because we'll be able to literally almost read each other's mind. So we're beyond language, will be beyond all the mind and fear activities. We'll be able to potentially physically manifest things in ways that are mind-blowing using our feelings again. And we're just on the cutting edge of all this spiritual connection to the mind and body. Like, I feel like we're in kindergarten and we have so much to go on this. But at least we're now recognizing the spirit is our leader, that God is within us, and that that God is love. Does it make sense?
Yeah. Absolutely. And, you know, Brian, my book, The Divine Principle, it talks about the internet quite often, and it refers to the internet. And I think in what you said just a moment ago about the different manifestations, we went through this age and this age, and now we're going through the spiritual age that we are beginning to develop that. If we look at the internet, it's truly attributes of creator, because if God is all-knowing, you can get on Google and find out anything you want to know. If God is all powerful, and if you can get on Google and find out information, and information is power, if we look at the idea and the truth that God is omnipresent, the internet is everywhere. So the internet,
yes.
You know, it's the web that we all have within us. You recently told me that you had done some reading through the Divine Principle. I'm curious to know what stuck out for you as the theme that you received from it.
Well, it actually was, love. It was, actually it's what we're talking
becoming that what you're talking
yeah,
about.
Yeah. It's what we're talking. It's really what we're talking. That's why we're here on it. You've got a beautiful gift. Well, actually, why don't you tell me? Yeah, please.
this wasn't meant to be a plug. I was just making time.
I would love for you to go ahead and tell me your feelings on the evolution of consciousness right now, because really we're all evolving, and this crisis being an opportunity to learn and grow for all of us. Right now, our whole world is in crisis, and I'm not sure that it is worse than ever, but it's more obvious than ever because of that internet. giving us more information. So our eyes can see what's going on in Syria today through the cell phones and so on. We can actually get instant information everywhere. And before they were able to hide the atrocities, now it's harder to hide those. So now we get to see that, have more fear, and respond to it. So we're right now coming into the response mode of like, oh, we've got a new presidency and all the problems that might exist with that. So everybody's in fear. Well, what it's doing to me is activating all of us to actively unify and come together in ways that we haven't done before. It used to be, with all the different sects of people, that if you were, a Muslim or a Black Lives Matter person or a Mexican person or whatever you are, your little organization is all that would show up. But these days, exampled by what was going on in the indigenous situation recently that is still going on in the Dakotas, yes, the Black Lives People Matter have shown up there. There's people from all over the world, Asians and Mexicans, and everybody's shown up as the Rainbow Tribe. And with the Native Americans, they've always talked about this prophecy of this Rainbow Tribe coming together and unifying, and that would be the time of change. Now, 2012 wasn't the time of change of the end of the world. What the Hopi and the Mayans really were saying was, it's the end of the world as we know it, meaning that old world was decaying and going away, and a new world was coming together. And there's a Hopi little thing. I'd actually like to read it to you real quickly. And it was actually written many years ago, but it talks about they were talking about the end of the world, and instead they give hope. And here's what was written. It says, "You've been telling people that this is the 11th hour. Well, now you must go back and tell people that this is the hour, and that there are things to be considered. Where are you living? What are you doing? What are your relationships? Are you in right relation? Where is your water? Know your garden. It is time to speak your truth. Create your community. Be good to each other and do not look outside of yourself for the leader." That's important. Do not look outside of yourself for the leader.
Very important.
"Then he clasped his hands together and smiled and said, 'This could be a good time. There is a river flowing now, very fast.'" And the river is the energy of life. "So there's a river flowing now, very fast. And it is so great and swift that there are those who will be afraid. And they will try to hold on to the shore where they're used to being, that old place. And they will feel that they're being torn apart, and they will suffer greatly. Know that the river has its destination. The elders say we must let go of the shore of that place that we've all been hanging on to, the ways of the old, and push off into the middle of the river and keep our eyes open and our heads above water. And I say, see who is in there with you and celebrate. And at this time in history, we are to take nothing personally, least of all ourselves. For the moment that we do, our spiritual growth and journey comes to a halt. The time for the lone wolf is over. Gather yourselves. Banish the word struggle from your attitude and your vocabulary. All that we do now must be done in a sacred manner and in celebration. We are the ones that we've been waiting for." Wow. How about
very
that?
Wow. And again, you and I are so connected by everything I've been doing in my recent past. Everything you're saying, it sounds like I'm listening to an interview, someone interviewing me. You just said, and I said before you got on air, and you even asked me, why don't I share my thoughts about the evolution of consciousness? Well, my thoughts are, being fortunate, pat on the back, being blessed to have Swamiji Visvayogi, Sai Baba, these godmen show up in my life doesn't make me special. It validates to me the level of work that I've put in myself. But that being said, being around such beings, I've come to know and realize my purpose on this earth, which is to help unify out struggle down. And before you came on the air, I started talking about get out of the fight. Get out of the fight with the people you love, people in the world, the people that might be strangers, people that you have a relationship. Get out of the internal dialogue and the fight.
And if you don't fight, there can only be peace, right?
Yeah, you know, and the fight could be a very silent one that happens within. You know, what do I choose? What do I do? I don't know what to do in this situation. And any kind of back and forthness, be it internally referenced or externally referenced, if you're fighting and you're trying to have one dominate the other, you know, the angel, the devil on the shoulder is clearly a devil. But are we very, very sure the angel on the other on the other shoulder is not the same devil in disguise? So if there's a back and forthness, we're not living in the heart, period, because the heart does not have such dialogue.
No. So our mind is the trickster. So when we let our spirit get past the mind, now I see the spirit is up above our head and coming through in your third eye and then trying to connect to our body. And the mind is like a plate. I see it as the thing that's not letting the light and the spirit from above come into our body because our mind and our ego and our control mechanisms in the way. So when I turn off my mind or mute the chatter of my mind or the control of my mind and let my heart take lead, I connect to spirit and suddenly magic happens. Music happens magically. Art happens magically. Physical things happen magically.
You know, it's like our own internal theme song begins to start playing.
Imagination, and you start to create. Yeah.
You know, and you said again, Brian, we must be walking the same walk, holding hands, because when we begin to realize that the first dominant fear we have, it's the first fear that filters the soul's light from expressing itself through these vehicles we know as our bodies. Exactly what you just said. So we have the capacity within us to not only change ourselves, and in turn, the world will lift higher. But that's still limiting the possibilities of what really lies within each and every person.
Mm-hmm. Well, so with all this fear that's in us right now about the election and the end of the world or problems or economy or whatever, what we all have to do is, instead of being a little pill bug and playing dead like possum, we have to come up like a peacock and unify and see ourselves in the eyes of others and come together. I don't see this as a Republican or a Democratic issue. I see this whole thing as a world issue on the wealthiest few in the world and all the wealthiest corporations and money and politics coming from those wealthy few in the world and so on, all driving to keep it. It's sort of the separation as the richest few against the rest of us. And so we ethics are the way to do that. Ethics come from your heart. Morals come from your mind. And ethics from our heart mean that we all collectively will unify, come together, and do what's right for all of us, which means maybe we don't buy their products and we start buying locally made products. We start loving one another and standing up. Like if for some reason our government decides to run Muslims out of the country, I say every Christian should sign up as a Muslim, everyone. And we should have 300 million Muslims all of a sudden registered. Totally. You know?
Totally. You know? And I love the idea that when we look at the North Dakota pipeline scenario, there's a lot happening there. And like I said, it's way beyond what it seems to be. Because through this event, people are standing up from all over the world that are collecting there, saying we have had enough. But also you can see that people are wanting something. Not only just have we had enough, they're wanting something greater. And this event is, again, back to the word I use, is excuse that has manifested to bring all these different ethnicities of people, all these different movements of people, Black Lives Matter, just all types of people to this location to unify and stand up for something that means way beyond what it looks like it's happening.
Well, water is life. And
it's life for everyone.
Yeah, for everyone. And it's the same. And if we go to Mars, we want to see if there's life on the planet. We have to see if there's water there. You know, it's
Brian, I have a question from the chat room from Don Danny. He wants to know, let me do some, here we go. I want to know what Brian thinks of artificial intelligence. Is artificial intelligence even possible?
Well, you know, there's everybody's this year got one of those little devices, Alexa, or what do they call it? The Echo. You know, it's just talking to your computer. It's a microphone to talk to your computer. Let it scan through a Google search and whatever. You can do it on the phone. Now, all that's the beginning of our artificial intelligence. I know the idea that a computer can learn our behaviors and patterns is happening more and more. And does it fear me that people were getting those implants on themselves? I think it's silly. Kind of like no matter how much science we have in all the labs, we've still never been able to make a blade of grass. And so making a brain that works in the same ethical and emotional and collective ways as the human, I don't know why I want that right now and what problems it would lead to. If you read our Declaration of Independence, it talks about the God's nature. Let me bring up the actual document, but it's actually quite interesting. So we have within us a connection to nature, and whenever we think of this artificial intelligence, I don't relate to it like I relate to connecting to each other in the trees and so on. It doesn't bring me joy. I would love, actually, here's the better idea. Buckminster Fuller said back in the 1960s or 70s that with all the robots and the and so on that we have, we should be using all that technology and all the physical stuff and the computers and information to plant our food, grow our food, control our water, clear our water, and so on. We should be able to create systems that take care of themselves so much that we no longer are enslaved to a financial system that's man-made and invented. We are no longer enslaved to having to go to some drudgery job 40 hours a week, but instead could spend that same 40 hours a week on spiritual matters. And my version of this artificial intelligence or whatever, or computers and so on, would be to use that to take away our need to be in drudgery and spend our time on spiritual matters and loving one another and doing what we love. So if people love to cook, instead of a robot cooking it for me, I would love to have a handmade, and with love put into it, because you can feel the love that goes into the energy of that.
I can attest to that, because my father, that's what he does all day long. He cooks for his loved ones, family members come in and out of the house like you can't imagine. And you can taste the love of my father and the food. It's
amazing. Well, you're a guitar player.
It's one of the ingredients.
You're a guitar player. All the great guitars were handmade back in the 60s and 70s. Absolutely. The ones that are made by robots suck.
Yeah, right. Brian, just a heads up, we're coming to the top of the hour, and my producer Joe has given us a couple of extra minutes due to the fact of the technical issues we had. Okay. Is there something you would like to leave us in closing, be it that the declaration you were going to read, or something you would like to leave us with of your own as a final thought, my brother? And if you would, on the outro of that, give us your contact information, please.
Oh, cool. Okay, do I go now?
Dig it. Go for it.
Go for it. Well, we mentioned the Declaration of Independence. It's actually quite an interesting document, and it talks about the laws of nature and of nature's God. Wow. So it connects us once again to nature. It's not saying one particular God. It's all God. It's God within everything. And then it says, you know, we hold these truths self-evident that all men are created equally. It should say all men and all people are created equally. But anyway, it says all men are created equally, and they are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights. Among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their powers from the consent of the governed. And that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, which are life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it and to institute a new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its power in such form as to them be most likely to affect their safety and happiness. So, you know, it calls for us to be in joy. It calls for us to be connected to nature. It calls for us to stand up for life of ourselves and all others and all beings, and liberty and freedom, and then pursuing happiness. So that's a beautiful document. I invite everybody to read it, the Declaration of Independence. It's the foundation of our country. It was based on love, on nature, on connecting to a God within everything, and happiness. So that's what we should be doing, feeling the feeling of happiness, smiling as much as it is. Everything's contagious. So when we smile, try it tonight. Walk around smiling, and you'll see other people smiling back. So give love, get love. And so life is simple, you know. So you wanted my connection.
My name, contact information, sir.
Brian. My name is Brian David Hardin. There's also another Brian Hardin that's in Nashville. That does the Daily Audio Bible. I am not him. I'm Brian David Hardin, and then I have a thing called New Ways with a K, like you know something. KNEWWAYS, newways.com. And it's new ways to evolve. On there, I've got films that I made with Dalai Lama, with Thomas Merton, who was a Catholic priest that had a really strong connection with Dalai Lama, with Mayan elders, with Hopi, with Lakota chiefs, with Tibetans, and then the founder of United Nation, and a bunch of other great interviews and videos. I'll put more and more up there, but it's all out of my own pocket. Things I love to do is talk about love and spirituality and the evolution of consciousness. So please join me. Sign up on the website if you can, and thank you so much for this opportunity to share with you.
Brian, thank you for being a phenomenal guest. I want to get you back on soon, sir, if we can, due to the fact that we had some technical issues. I love your passion, brother. I can feel it. I can sense it very effortlessly.
You're great too. We'll have to hang out sometime. I'll come to Memphis and we'll play some music.
Who knows? Maybe we can do a project together.
There we go.
Start a lot of trouble. Love it. Everyone, Mr. Brian Hardin, what a phenomenal guest here on Center of Light Radio. My guest next week is going to be Mother Goddess, and you can find her work at lovehasone.org. Pretty powerful lady. Pretty powerful audience she has. My name is Keith Anthony Blanchard, your host of Center of Light Radio, Monday night, 6 p.m. Eastern Time. If you can, go to YouTube and look up Center of Light Radio and subscribe to my channel. Leave me some comments and also give me a thumb. It helps the survival. No, wrong word. It helps to support Center of Light Radio to spread that message faster to other people. I bid you all a wonderful evening. Stay warm.
I love you, Keith.
17.
I love you.
I'm back at you, brother. Peace, love, and light all. Inside.